I am here today with Alison Berry, who says a same surname as me, but we're not actually related in that sense, are we?
No, definitely not. No.
Hi, Alison. How are you?
I'm great, thank you. It's really lovely to be here. We obviously met at Big Church Festival when I was on the Christians Against Poverty stand, and you came up. So great to have the chance to chat more today.
Now, Christians Against Poverty, I've known of it more than I know it personally. It's not something I've ever had to physically interact with myself. A church I was at, there was a similar kind of financial help thing. But Christians Against Poverty, I mean, it's becoming more and more widely known, which is brilliant. I'm seeing you more involved with the sort of trying to get into the politics stuff to make people aware, which is fantastic. Just give us a brief overview. Other than it's Christians Against Poverty, which is the name, what is Christians Against Poverty all about?
So Christians Against Poverty started in somebody's spare bedroom. A guy called John Kirkby founded Christians Against Poverty 28 years ago in Bradford, as I say, in a little spare room. And he had real lived experience of the whole debt industry, actually on the slightly dodgy side of the debt industry, so to sort of the debt collection, taking out, you know, people who took out high interest loans. Fast forward not too long, he lost his business, he lost his home, his marriage broke down. And after that, he found Jesus. Somebody introduced him to Jesus, and he found the one that forgave the biggest debt that he ever had. And then a very wise Christian friend said, you know, you probably need to use your experience to help out other people who found themselves in absolutely desperate situation, trapped in those chains of debt and poverty. So with a £10 donation, he sets up Christians Against Poverty, and now is an organisation across all four nations of the UK. We always work in partnership with the local church. Well over 800 churches are partnered with us. And our primary work is helping people trapped in debt and poverty. And we do that by offering free, completely non-judgmental debt advice, always through the church. And we offer that very powerful combination of really professional debt advice. We offer the supportive local church community and that wraparound emotional care. And most importantly, we offer the love of Jesus Christ and really offer life to the full to people whom their life experience is anything but that. So that's the primary work of Christians Against Poverty. But if you're happy for me to go on a little bit more, we also offer some other really key services. So we offer life skills communities, job clubs to help people back into community. And we offer money coaching, what was known for many years as the CAP money course, to help people just with budgeting. And then our advocacy role is so important. We do a lot of that. And it's really important because the systemic change that is needed to address the root cause of debt and poverty in the UK is a critical part of our work too.
I think it's interesting. I'm picking up on the reintegration into community is my wording of that one, because that's one of the things about debt is it isn't just you haven't got money to pay for stuff. Actually, it kind of isolates you. It ostracizes you. People ostracize you. You ostracize yourself almost because you feel, well, I can't contribute. Therefore, I shouldn't be in part of this. So the ability to help people back into community is always going to be, and it's exciting to hear you talk about, but it's always going to be such a central part of, yeah, let's help you with the debt that you've got and the poverty that you're struggling with. But at the same time, how do we get you to feel empowered in yourself in order that you can be part of community?
It is so important. I mean, every year at Christians Against Poverty, we release a client report, which, as the name suggests, just we survey our clients to find out more information and we can provide those statistics. And obviously behind every statistic is a person's life. And more often than that, it's a whole family and friends that have been impacted. And so we have some really good information to be able to share. And actually, the type of debt that people have is is often priority debt these days because they cannot afford the simple things that they need just to survive. So it's things like council tax arrears, it's things like rent arrears. And those things have significant consequences if you don't pay them. And therefore, the ongoing impact on people's lives that just makes them isolated, and the massive impacts on their debt, on their mental health from being in debt. So our client report was just released in May. And if anybody's interested, it's available through our CAP website, which is capuk.org. You can search up our latest client report. But 90% of our clients said that they had sleepless nights due to debt. 79% are scared to open their post. 75% scared to answer the phone, and over 60% scared to open their door, and 45% of people scared to leave their home. That is so much. That is the thief coming to rob and steal and destroy. And this is, you know, it gets me every time that 46% of our clients say that they had attempted or considered suicide as a way out of their debt before they came to us for help. So, you know, other organizations, and there are other organizations that offer free professional regulated debt advice. Citizens Advice Bureau do a great job, and there are other organizations. But people who are living with that reality, they need the community support more than ever before. And it is seeing every person as an individual made in the unique, you know, the precious image of God, that, and we just want to, for them to see themselves as God sees them. And that's why inviting them into that loving community where they can start to rebuild their confidence, their self-worth, and to know that they're, is more to life than the situation that they have found themselves into in is so important.
Just come back to the isolating thing. I mean, just sharing part of my own story, just briefly, I think it might help, because we had a business. The business was growing really well. We sold our house, we invested into that. It was great. And then the recession hit and we found ourselves with 60,000 quid of business debt. Now that's a bit more specialized and unique. And we found ourselves back in, you know, this is pre 2010, we went to a business debt management thing that's, you know, paid for by the financial services and all that. And it was great. And they were wonderful. But the one element that I always felt missing is I just missed that element of faith, because it isn't just business debt. Yeah, we had that. It wasn't our fault, it's the way that it went. But on top of that, we're still people. And there's still a spiritual element. And I really remember vividly going to a church. We were new to the area and saying, look, we're not coming here for money. We've just found ourselves with 60,000 quid of business debt. We just want some prayer. And the church sadly was not positively responsive, because you could see they were already thinking, you just want money. And we were really clear, like, we don't want your money. We just want some support. We're alone. We're scared. And what was one of the ones you said, 75% of people not wanting to answer the phone, 60% people scared to open a door. I remember that one absolutely vividly, because you don't know who's going to come knocking on your door. Are they going to act honorably and righteously, or are they going to just try and bypass the law to get what they want?
Yeah, exactly. And that is the reality of many of our clients. And knowing that actually gives us the credibility as Christians Against Poverty. We invite in we have a head office or support centre, as we want to call it, in Bradford, which is where the charity obviously started. And that's where all of our Financial Conduct Authority debt advisors and some of our other support service, they're based there, and our free phone number that people can get hold of us. But what's really important is that we invite in representatives from the credit industry to talk to them about some of these systemic issues. And we also invite in, you know, the regulators of the debt collection industry. And they work with us really, really well. And we can build up this evidence bank of, well, this is what you say that you're committed to, but do you know what? That's this individual client's experience. And because we have, you know, cases from all over the UK, that gives us the voice to be able to speak for the voiceless. And that's such an important part of our work to bring about that change.
Which feeds back into Christians Against Poverty. It's not just a bunch of people that thought, oh, let's do something to help people. Actually, the Christian part of that is going to be central, obviously, because of what you've already shared. But in terms of what you're trying to help people to do, it isn't just getting rid of financial debt. We had a letter saying you are now debt free. It was great. But then there's all the other stuff you've got to do. And that, again, that's why I say I really love what you do, because I would have preferred back then, if we'd have known about you, that we could have come to you, because it was that element of faith, of spirituality, of somebody who's on the same page, who knows, yeah, I'm a Christian, I feel like a failure because I'm not supposed to have faith and that's supposed to win. And those parts of it, which we would love to have had help, was missing. So that's why I'm so, I guess, encouraged and excited by the way that Christians Against Poverty actually tackle this, because it's not just people against poverty, it's Christians against poverty. And that means something much, much bigger than just helping people with debt.
Yeah. Absolutely. And it's the fact that we are Christians against poverty, not just nice people against poverty, means that we serve and we will see clients of all faiths and none. That is, it is never a blocker to somebody receiving our services. We would never force our faith on anybody. It's all very gentle. But we're always really clear from the first call and the first visit, we offer to pray with clients. We always visit people in their own home if it's appropriate to do so. Never just one person on their own. We always go with a befriender. The centre manager would do that, and always offer prayer. And people open up. They will reveal. It doesn't actually take much often to reveal their story when you visit somebody there, but to not offer the most precious thing when you're there seeing somebody would be a real shame. But yes, we do it because we are Christians, and we do it from the overflow of our own discipleship journey, because we know how much God has done for us. So why would we not offer that to someone else? And actually, interestingly, the experience of people who go in and meet clients in people's homes is that it increases their own faith and discipleship journey, because often they get to pray with clients for miracles, and they see miracles with people who have never experienced answered prayer and miracles before. And I think there's something that God really honors in that space when he's meeting people who have never come across him before, would have never walked through the door of a church, and yet they meet a Christian in their own home who prays for a miracle, and they see it happen. It's utterly astonishing. And the other way that, I mean, our faith comes through because we are part of a rich Christian heritage in this nation that says, actually, poverty is not okay. It's not God's plan for this nation. And we need to change, not just one life at a time, but we need to pray in and speak to powers and authorities to say, this is not okay.
So really, Christians Against Poverty, yes, you're going to help the individual who comes and says, I've got debt, I don't know what to do, help me. That's one part of it. But at the same time, you're also trying to change the system that is creating so many more problems that needs to be for that individual. So you're helping the individual, but you're also helping communities and, you know, at large as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And that ripple effect goes everywhere. I think even when you help the individual, and obviously the individual is the person you really want to help in that moment, often you don't just help them, but often you break some generational chains of something that's been going on, and the impact on the wider family and friends who, you know, the impact of debt is relationship breakdown. It's many things. So often that can have a massive impact, but the systemic changes and things, I mean, just to give one small example. Quite a common way for people to get out of debt is a debt relief order. If they don't have a huge amount of debt and they don't have extensive assets like a house, for example. So that's a very common way that about 70% of clients will be able to go debt free. There is a £90 fee, or there was a £90 fee associated with doing that. If you are up to £30,000 in debt, and you've got people knocking at your door, you don't have a spare £90. We campaigned for about 5 years to get that abolished. And in the spring budget this year, it was abolished, as well as the eligibility in terms of the amount of debt and the level of assets was also increased. But yes, you need organisations like ours not to just work with the individual, but go, there's some systemic change that needs to happen here too. So that's a small impact, but has had a massive impact. We had a backlog of clients, about 1,000, who would have only been eligible for bankruptcy, but when the rules change at the end of this month, they'll be able to go through a DRO and be debt-free within 10 days.
Wow, what a difference. That's amazing work.
Yeah, absolutely amazing.
What's your story then? So you're working with Christians Against Poverty. There's clearly a background of life for you as well. What's your story of faith, and how did you find yourself working with Christians Against Poverty in the role that you're doing now?
So I have been to church all my life. I would say that my faith really stepped up a gear and became very meaningful when I went to university, which was some time ago. Fortunately, you know, your listeners can't see me, so they can't see what age I am. It was some time ago, over 30 years ago, I was at university. And I had I did business studies and French at university and specialised in marketing. And I had a very strong sense that I should or would end up working for a Christian organization in marketing. That didn't happen. And a very wise older Christian friend said, do you know what? I think you'd be way more used to a Christian organization if you go into the commercial world, get all of your training and experience there. So that's what I did. And I pursued a commercial career. I've had a very rich career working, started in chocolate and confectionery, worked in the toy industry for a long time. I had a small foray running my own business. And then I did a long period of time working for Mars, the very large confectionery company, in marketing innovation. Absolutely loved that role. And always, as I say, thought maybe I'm never going to work for a Christian charity or just be part of, you know, my other sorts of life. So that was where I was until about 2 years ago. But if I just take you back about 11 years, my CAP journey, Christians Against Poverty, started when I seemed to go to a few Christian festivals and events such as Spring Harvest or other ones. And there was always this Christians Against Poverty stand. And I had never heard of them, didn't really know what they did, but ended up talking to them. And then turned out that another couple of people at my home church had also been at some of these events. And so we started to talk about CAP and Christians Against Poverty, how we should get involved. A group of us went to do what was then the CAP money course, to learn how to do this budgeting course. Went and did the training, heard John Kirkby speak. He was at the training and came back from that, thought, oh, maybe we should set up a debt centre. So I carried on doing the money coaching about a year later. So 10 years ago, we set up the CAP Debt Centre in my local town, which is Egham in Surrey. So opened a debt centre there. And so I was part of that team, but always thought CAP would be a volunteering passion, carried on delivering the money coaching, including volunteering in a women's prison. My company Mars were very generous about, you know, I could flex my days to go and do that volunteering and stuff. So yes, always loved the organization, had been up to the head office in Bradford, been to conferences, but I was very happily eating chocolate, making chocolate for a living. Loved Mars. They're a great company, really, really ethical, you know, very principled company, privately owned. But as I say, God had other ideas. And then my job, although I loved the company, my job stopped giving me joy. That's the only way that I can describe it. It just stopped giving me the joy that I'd had. And I sort of struggled on, not really knowing what I'd do next. And then I took I just took the time off between Christmas and New Year, as you know, most of us do. And because I follow CAP on all their social channels, the job that I'm now in popped up on the social channels as having a vacancy, as God's timing did that. And I went, I'm going to apply for that. And a bit of a whirlwind of a few online interviews later or two, they offered me the job. So I'm the region lead for Christians Against Poverty for the Southeast. Just happened that they needed somebody that lived in the Southeast, which is exactly where I was.
Funny that.
So funny that. Yeah. And again, God's timing was really perfect. So 2 years on, I've been doing this role, and it is an utter joy that I get to lead all of the debt centres and our other services and church partnerships in the Southeast. So yes, that's sort of a potted history of my journey. And I think I've learned, I guess what I've learned on the way is that what was planted in me when I left university obviously took 30 years to come to fruition, but I don't regret any of the time in between. I'm a strong believer that in God's economy, nothing is wasted. Amen. And the time that I had in all of those various careers are so useful now, working for a Christian charity with obviously naturally less resources and less, you know, obviously money, people, training, experience, all of that sort of stuff. But, and God has given me those experiences, but actually that time in the world doing all of those roles was so valuable in its way. I used to have a little routine that I used to drive into work, and as I drove into the car park, I used to just pray, "Here I am, God, use me for your glory today." And time again, he put people in my path, you know, that you just wouldn't expect. But yes, that time was never wasted. So if people are thinking about giving everything up and changing it, you know, God uses you where you are, and he will use those experiences at some time to his glory.
I wanted to pick up on the fact you said you'd lost having joy in your day job.
Yeah.
Because one of the things that it doesn't matter who I interview, who I speak with, either radio or not, and we've had this in our own life, quite frequently something happens which to all intents and purposes is not good. Losing joy is not a good thing. Difficulty because you've been told the house you're living in is being sold and you've got to move, which is what happened to us early April. There's something which is not a positive experience, and yet that's the opportunity, almost like a springboard for God to, when we're willing, to be doing something else amazing. But as you said, nothing we've done is wasted. So the experience we had in our last house is not wasted. And the experience you had at Mars is not wasted, because now you're doing it all you know, but you're using it in a different way. And I love how you phrased that you lost joy, but I'm guessing from talking to you and meeting you, you found joy in what you're doing again.
Yeah, I absolutely love the work I do. It is a joy every day, because I think if I could sum it up, every day I do get to hear about, experience utter brokenness, and yet every day I get to see glimpses of God's kingdom yet to come, breaking through into the here and now. And I don't think there's a bigger joy than seeing that happen. That's not to say that I didn't love the work that I was doing beforehand, but I think, yes, God was doing something, and taking the joy and removing it was a clear sign that something needs to change. And my other reflection in that was, I also realized that you also need to wait on God's timing, because had I have just gone, I've lost my joy, I'm leaving, then actually the role that I'm in now wouldn't have been available. So there was a sense of, I needed to work through what ended up being about 9 months of feeling I've lost my joy in order that I could step into what was next. Just to trust into that space.
I can echo that as well, in as much as so often we think, well, this is what God's called me to do, therefore I need to go and do this. But as the wise Christian said to you, Well, let's try a different route, and maybe God's got a different way of doing things. And actually, what an amazing training ground you've had through the company Mars, who you know, with all the stuff you've gained from that and gleaned from that, that you can then use in a different way. It's lovely to see how God doesn't waste anything. I mean, that was probably a good experience, but even the good God uses, and also the bad He uses.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, everything from I've got to when I was at Mars, I say the last 5 years I was doing innovation projects and learning to do them really quickly. So obviously following great processes, but how can we be a bit more agile is a word used often in business. And actually, what am I doing right now at Christians Against Poverty? I'm involved in a small team that are looking at how we can be way more agile and really hear the voice of our clients and our church customers and other partners, that we do obviously listen to them and we hear that, but how can we take that and really quickly discern what is the right move to make? And actually, that's just one example of how something that you learn in one space is very transferable. It might not instantly look like it, but actually what you've learned, and as I say, what God has planted in you, then it's very, very transferable.
Fab. Let's just go through this scenario. So somebody's, I'm in debt. They've stumbled across CAP. What's that? That's Christians Against Poverty. What do I do? I'm struggling with debt. What is it that people can expect as an experience when they're feeling probably terrified, rubbish? Like you said, tragically, so many people, just too many people, are pushed into feeling like I'm going to end my life because this is too much. What is it that someone's going to experience and can expect when they send you that email or make that phone call to you?
So the first thing that would happen, if anybody, any of your listeners are struggling or know somebody that is, the first thing I'd say is, please, the bravest thing that you can do is to ask for help. It can often be the hardest thing. And we know that on average, some of our clients wait about 18 months from knowing there's a problem to making that first initial step. So encouraging people to make that first step is really, really important. If there is a debt center in your local area and you can find that out, you can just go on our website, again, capuk.org, get help. You can find everything there. You can just put in get help and put in your postcode and it will say what's available in your local area. And then if it was debt help, you'd phone our free phone number. And then some lovely, lovely people would find out some information about you. They would explain our service to you. And then the next thing, they would then look up your local centre and make an appointment for you. And then what would happen is that the local centre, which would be the centre manager, and they would always bring a befriender with them, another member of the team. So they would come, you know, by arrangement, they would then come to your house. And then it's sort of, I'd call it a sort of a three-stage process rather than a three-visit process, but sort of think of it like three visits. So the first one is really they would come and they would find out about your situation. You know, they want to hear your story. They want to hear what that is. What, you know, and they would find out if there's any basically emergency situation. So have you got bailiffs knocking at your door? How can we help with those instant things? We also offer emergency aid in terms of support for fuel payments, or is it a food shop that's needed? All of those sorts of how can we just get alongside you right now? So a bit of a just understanding you and your situation and how we're going to be able to help. And then the next stage would be what is required in order to give you regulated debt advice. And that is finding out the specifics of your debt, gathering all of the paperwork in a lot of detail, and going through the income and expenditure that you have in order that we've got the full picture. And again, say the Financial Conduct Authority regulate and authorize our debt advice, and so we have to have all of that provided. And then there would be and that goes off to all of our debt advisors up in Bradford. They prepare a very tailored debt advice letter package, and then the centre team would come and again meet personally. It's all face to face, and would then go through what is the debt advice that is being offered, which could be a number of routes. It could be a repayment plan if the debt is of a certain level. It could be something like insolvency, of which there is a debtor relief order, or there are bankruptcy, or it could be something else. But they would do that advice, and then the person would, the debt centre manager would explain that. And if it is, say, for example, a debt relief order, they would have the paperwork there at that final visit for people to sign if they were ready to do it. And as I say, because that is quite a simple, fast track process, within maybe just a matter of weeks, that person would be completely debt free, and we would want to absolutely celebrate. And all of the way along that journey, there is the emotional wraparound care of inviting them into community, finding out, you know, have they got toddlers? Have they got small children? Come along to our toddler group. You know, just inviting them in from where they've been isolated to realizing they are not on their own anymore. Inviting them to appropriate events, meeting up with the befriender in between if it just needs some more help with the paperwork. Because often, as I say, people have, you know, when people are in crisis, they can't think straight. You know, no fault, no judgment, but, you know, sometimes they just need a bit of help getting things together. So yeah, all the way along that journey. And then, you know, most of all, we want to be there, whether it's a short journey or a long journey to debt free, just to walk with people, because it is a bold, brave step. And sometimes it means some changes for them in order to get to that debt free point. It might be some help with budgeting. It might be actually pointing them, signposting them to other services that could help and support, if it was finding steps back into employment through a CAP job club, if there is one, or another community-based group that will just give them that sense of self-worth. And actually, it's all about giving people a hand up, not a handout.
Which I think is part of that empowerment thing, which again,
yes,
is mirrored from individual, okay, let's help you with your debt, through to, by the way, government, this isn't working and we need to change this. So it's that sort of two things going on, and there's many strands, but there's effectively two parts of the same thing, isn't there?
Yes, absolutely. So you can you need to empower the individual, but part of empowering our clients today and in the future is to make government aware where it simply isn't working. And part of the process that we go through, for example, is even checking whether there are benefits that they could be eligible for, because often a lot of people, again, don't realize that they're entitled to do things. Again, we partnered with Turn to Us to launch a benefits calculator, again, available through our website. And actually, we've identified millions and millions of pounds of unclaimed benefits, essentially. Yeah. And that can make a massive, massive difference. But again, we continue to use that data and evidence to say, you know, government, you've put aside this money from taxpayers saying we need to protect the most vulnerable, and yet they are just going unclaimed, things such as pension credits and other things that people don't realize that they are actually eligible for.
Which is another part of what I just love behind what you're doing, the motivation and the heart. So thank you for just sharing with us, really, that, you know, someone coming to what's CAP? Oh, Christian Against Poverty. Oh, what's that? Because I think that, like you say, it is a bold step to pick up the phone and say, I'm struggling, I need help, because that is an admittance that you're failing somehow, somewhere, which is a really hard thing to be able to accept. But it's wonderful that we've got people like Christians Against Poverty who can step into that void, that breach, and say, it's okay, I know there's a void ahead of you, but let's cross it together, because here's a stepping stone and here's another stepping stone. So rather than seeing the mountain to try and climb, it's let's just take a step, let's take another step, and actually you can get there. But walking with somebody hand in hand, effectively, which is I love what you're doing.
Yeah.
How do people get hold of Christians Against Poverty? What's the best way of getting hold of you?
I think the absolute best way is to go through our website, so capuk.org, and you can find everything from that in terms of, if you're looking for our benefits calculator, you'll find that. If you're looking for help, and the reason that I point people to the website is because you can look for it by postcode and it will tell you then. But obviously, if it is debt help, it will then just point you straight to our free phone number. So you can call that. So that's definitely the best place. And it'll also, if you're just interested in campaigning with us, for example, then again, there's all of the information on there. So that's definitely the best route. Go to capuk.org and you will find everything you need to know and more.
Alison from Christians Against Poverty, it's been a delight talking to you, finding out some of your own heart, your own story, as well as I suppose that the bits we don't see behind the scenes of Christians Against Poverty, which is wonderful to learn more about that and just make it into a really understandable way. So thank you so much for your time today. Have a great rest of your day.
Great. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Pure 24/7 Radio is listener supported, which means we are free, online and always pure because of the generous support of our listeners. If you would like to contribute financially, please visit pure247radio.org. If you'd like to find out how we use your money, please visit the Our Cost section. Any donation of any size will help keep us on air and broadcasting for free. Thank you.